Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Center for International Governance Innovation, or CG, as we say. My name is Fred Kuntz, and I'm the Vice President of Public Affairs here at CG. I'd like to begin tonight by thanking our regular event sponsor, Wordsworth Books, for their ongoing support of CG's signature lecture series. And I'd especially like to thank our event co-sponsor tonight, the Balsley School of International Affairs, for making this event possible. Welcome to those joining us from around the world through our live webcast. And following this evening's address, we welcome questions from both audiences at the microphones here at CG or through the live chat function on your screen. Please remember to state your name and to keep the questions brief. Tonight, we have the privilege of welcoming three historical experts to the CG stage to discuss what six more years may have looked like had President John F. Kennedy of the United States and Soviet Chairman Nikita S. Khrushchev been able to continue their terms in office through 1963 to 1969. Both leaders had been deeply shaken by the 1962 Cuban Missile Crisis that brought the world to the brink of nuclear war. And as a result, history has wondered what their future confrontations or collaborations might have looked like. However, in 1963, Kennedy was assassinated. And in 1964, Khrushchev was removed in a coup. So here tonight to help us imagine what might have happened are Sergei Khrushchev, a senior fellow at the Thomas J. Watson Jr. Institute for International Studies at Brown University. He grew up in Kiev, Ukraine, the son of the Soviet chairman. Trained as a nuclear engineer, Sergei has developed over the years into an acclaimed political scientist, historian, and writer. He's authored books and articles about his father, including Khrushchev on Khrushchev and Nikita Khrushchev, Crises and Missiles. He brings a unique and intimate knowledge of Nikita Khrushchev's time in office, and we're thankful to have him here in Waterloo tonight as our featured speaker. Jim Blight is the CG Chair of Foreign Policy Development at the Balsley School of International Affairs. And since leaving the field of psychology to study at the Harvard Kennedy School of Government, Jim has become an expert in critical oral history research in collaboration with Janet Lang and has investigated several critical events in U.S. history with this innovative method. Jim has been involved in the making of films, including The Fog of War, 11 Lessons from the Life of Robert S. McNamara, and Virtual JFK, which CG will be screening on November 21st. And so Jim's expertise on the history and governance of JFK will be a valuable contribution to tonight's event. And Janet Lang, who is our moderator tonight. And Janet is a research professor at the Balsley School and in the Department of History at the University of Waterloo. As mentioned, Janet has collaborated with Jim on critical oral history research, and she's co-authored several books, including Becoming Enemies and Virtual JFK, the book that accompanies the film. Janet brings to the conversation a deep understanding of this evening's topic, and we're grateful for her participation. It's a very special program this evening, with some video as well as presentations and a discussion. So please join me now in welcoming all of tonight's guests, Sergei Khrushchev, Jim Blight, and Janet Lang.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Fred. It's really a pleasure for all of us to be here, and we're grateful that you've, so many of you have taken the time to come and be with us tonight as we try to sort of push the frontier a little bit from history to what we call virtual history, and to try to do it in a very database kind of way, and to think about sort of what might have been, but also to think about why that might have been interesting and some of the implications of that. Now, I want to set just a little bit of the context here of how we're going to proceed. We think of this, we're all three of us here are very good friends. Jim and I have been married we're in our 37th year, I think, right? Is that right? Yeah, 37th year. Close. And we've remained wonderfully good friends throughout that time. And we've known Sergei since the early 80s, and he's been a dear friend and a very, very valuable colleague, as you can imagine, since we've spent decades studying the period of the 60s in which Kennedy and Khrushchev were so crucial. So we will have a bit of an informal style. I will feel quite free to occasionally use these signs here that I have for my two dear friends and colleagues that say, 1 minute more, please, and another one that says, time to end it. Now, because we want
to... You can only try to imagine what happens after that. Given her Italian background.
We won't. We'll try to not get to that point. We'll also have the ability, let's say, to interrupt each other. Basically, if there's something that Sergei has said that I think Jim might want to respond to, or vice versa. So it's a very informal atmosphere that we're setting up, and we hope that by the end of this time, you will also feel very comfortable then in asking your questions to Jim and Sergei, and we'll have the microphones there, and we'd be very interested in your comments. Now, I see also a nice age distribution, let's say, in the audience. Some of you are in our cohort, and you remember these times that we're going to be talking about. Others of you, clueless in terms of experiencing it, but we're grateful that you've come to want to learn about it. And so what we're going to try to do is to create a time machine. And we're going to try to do it in a couple of ways, but we want to try to put you back, if you're in that age group, put you back into that time, or if you're too young, we're going to have you travel into that time and see if you can begin to get a glimmer of what it was like then, because part of what we're talking about in getting to know these two amazing leaders is you have to get their creations of their time. So you have to understand a little bit about that period. So what I want to do first of all is we're going to have two short videos. Each one is about 5 minutes. And one starts with a dramatic reenaction of a very key moment in the Cuban Missile Crisis, and then a little bit following that the following year. And it's an excerpt from a wonderful film that was made in the 70s called The Missiles of October. Maybe some of you have seen it. But it focuses on the two leaders. And then we're going to do a clip from November of 1963 that many of you who are alive at that point will, I think, clearly remember. So I'm going to spray and throw out here some of my time machine dust to you and invite you now to watch these two videos. So here we have the basics, the crucible of nuclear fear that Kennedy and Khrushchev lived through. Their transformation, really, in an interesting way. After that, the potential for the two of them to have worked together 6 more years after that. And then the murder. And so for over half a century, or about a half a century, people have wondered, what if? What might have been? And there's all kinds of ways to speculate about this. But we think what we want to do is to first ground it in as much understanding as we can get of these two men, so that it's like if you know somebody very well. You then can imagine, somewhat plausibly, what they might have done. But if you don't know them at all, then it's just a game of, well, this could have happened or that. So we have a very interesting opportunity here tonight to, I think, use both Jim Blight and Sergei Khrushchev to, in a sense, channel John Kennedy and Nikita Khrushchev, try to introduce you a little bit more to these people, to some of the main snapshots of their life, their political life, that molded them, and first of all, begin to let you know them a little bit more, and then get into that very provocative what-if question. So I want to point, first of all, to one of, I'll call a snapshot, that Kennedy and Khrushchev lived through. And this was in 1961, April of 1961, the Bay of Pigs. And what you can see here is that it was a disaster. So you had a group of Cuban exiles that were trained by the CIA try to invade and take over Cuba. And it was a disaster in any way that you could possibly define that word. Within 72 hours, the Castro government had either killed or imprisoned all of those exiles who had landed. It was a huge defeat for the United States. Not huge in terms of a big military buildup, but in terms of prestige and in terms of here's a new president. He'd been inaugurated in January of 61. And early on, Nikita Khrushchev had congratulated Kennedy on his election. There's a very interesting correspondence between the two leaders that I'd encourage you to take a look at anytime. It's all on the web. A few months after this congratulatory letter, the Bay of Pigs happens. So, Sergei, I want to sort of ask you, first of all, could you talk about sort of your father's initial feelings on sort of first when Kennedy is elected, and then very quickly his reactions, you know, within months to what Kennedy, what he thinks Kennedy has ordered with regard to the Bay of Pigs?
As my father told to the President Kennedy in Vienna, that I was on your side during the elections, because he didn't like Nixon, and he thought the Nixon will be not good president to improve our relations, and he also have the feeling to be deceived and betrayed by the President Eisenhower by U-2 flight. And he thought that it will be good enough possibility to start new relations, because he wanted to stop arms race, he wanted to resolve problem over the Berlin, and he wanted to improve these relations. And Cuba was somewhere between these things, because when Castro took power, he was unknown for the Soviet Union. And the Soviet intelligence and scientists told that he, we don't know who is he, but for sure he is pro-American and maybe American CIA agent. And it was true. First, where Castro came in April 59 to Washington, D.C. But he was denied by the president. And the Cold War, if you push him off one side, he will be just invited on the opposite side. And Soviet Union started cautiously supply him with the arms, with their weapons. It was the rule at that time, if you have somebody who don't like your adversary, help him. But my father didn't want to be too much involved in this. Castro became a hero in the Soviet Union, for the hero of Soviet youth. And I asked my father, why will not defend him, will not invite him in the Warsaw Pact? And he told that, We don't know him. We don't know who is he. If we'll invite him, America will attack them and they will start the nuclear war. And this time maybe he will shake hands with American generals on their territory. So when the Americans or exiles started this invasion, my father thought that it is unclear for him why Americans did them, but of course they will defeat Castro, because if they decided to make such unpopular move, that means that they decided this. And he told it, so it's happened. Historically, the Cuba will be free soon or later, but maybe now it is not time ripe enough. But it was the big changes happened at that moment, because the Castro officially announced that now he's joined Soviet bloc, an obligation which superpower to protect all your allies, even risking the war. And Cuba became for the Soviet Union the same as West Berlin for the United States, small, useless piece of land, deep inside hostile territory. But if not protected, you will lose your face. And this is the main consequences of the Bay of Pigs.
Mm. Can you tell me, Sergei, how your father thought about Kennedy after that? Did he think of him, I mean, as you said, he was happy that Kennedy won the election. Was he still happy that Kennedy won the election after that?
My father was the real politician, and he looked at the Kennedy as the president of the United States, our adversary, but he told, we are not electing, and we're not putting the leaders of the countries on their office, not removing them. So we have to deal with that people who is there. And he thought that he will be able to negotiate with the President Kennedy. I'm not support this mythology that he thought that the President Kennedy was weak, he can manipulate this. It's absolutely untrue. And it also is untrue because he can manipulate American president. I think it is part of the American mythology, because America like Superman story. And Superman, first you have to be weak, pushing back, and then at last you show that you are strong.
I think a lot of people in this room share your view of your father's view of the United States of America.
Jim, let me pick up a little bit on that point, though. After this debacle, and it really was just, Kennedy feared initially that he might be impeached right after that. So maybe Khrushchev wasn't thinking of him as a weak leader. Was Kennedy thinking of himself as a weak leader? I mean, how did he respond to this? He's a brand new president, doesn't quite know where the men's room is, and bingo, he has his first big defeat.
Yeah. A historian named Robert Dalek has written that 1961 was the worst year a president ever had, a president of the United States. It was just one brutal thing after another. The Bay of Pigs to Kennedy was a humiliation. It wasn't a disaster in the sense that the Vietnam War was a disaster or the Iraq War was a disaster in terms of blood and treasure. But, and this is the hardest piece of it to get across to our students these days, and even it's hard for us to understand, how a bunch of guys with beards and green outfits on this little pipsqueak island could have defeated the United States of America in anything at all, but a military confrontation? And we have to look at this just a little bit more closely. Kennedy was entrapped by his advisors. His advisors took a look at him and they said to themselves, many of the advisors, especially in the CIA, but also in the military, he doesn't know, I believe the expression of the day would have been shit from Shinola, maybe some of you remember that. Ass from elbow, that was another one that Kennedy particularly liked himself. But he doesn't know anything about all of this. Now, Eisenhower had already okayed the plan that resulted in the invasion at the Bay of Pigs. So Kennedy was left with with the really, I mean, it was a terrible situation. He could turn it down, he could eliminate it, but then what is he doing? He is overturning a policy of one of America's greatest war heroes, General Dwight David Eisenhower, lately the president, a two-term president of the United States, or he can let it go forward. But he didn't like this. He did not like this idea. He used every opportunity he had to sort of scale it back, scale it down. But the advisors who were pushing this thought, if we can just land a bunch of these exiles in Cuba, Kennedy will not be able to say no to the request for troops. He won't have a choice. We are the United States of America. We won the First World War. We won the Second World War. We did this, we did that. Remember, this is 1961. I mean, the arrogance is right up to here, not in Kennedy, but in these advisors who are much older than Kennedy and who had very senior positions in the Second World War. They're saying, look, we put them on that, we put these guys on that beach, they pick up the radio, they say, help us, we are free Cuba. Well, as a matter of fact, there were thousands of US Marines 2 miles away from the Bay of Pigs on ships. And when Kennedy said, no, you're not going in, the military advisors and the CIA turned apoplectic. They absolutely couldn't believe this. They sent contingents to the White House and said, we've got to go through with this. Don't you understand, Mr. President? We've got to do this and we've got to do that. So what happened was almost the worst possible thing. It was humiliating. Yes, America could have sent in the Marines. America could have nuked Cuba. It could have done a lot of different things. But Kennedy was trying to build a new kind of relationship, the same kind, I think, that Sergei's father was trying to build, with the other side in order to reduce the danger of an all-out nuclear war, which everybody thought about every day in this period. This period will lead up to a point where there'll be 50,000 nuclear warheads on the planet, and about 98% of them were owned by Washington and Moscow. Now, Kennedy...
Well, but hold that thought.
This is just like breakfast.
Sergei, as Jim is presenting this, which it is quite right, and I don't mean to...
You mean about breakfast?
No. Oh. About... So here's this... The invasion has happened, and the U.S. does have strong military support, very close to Cuba, but doesn't use it. Did your father sort of, how did he interpret that? Do you know?
Really, no, he never talked about this, and I don't know. He told that he didn't understand why Americans started such unpopular invasion and not just finish it. Mm. It was not logical for him because from the point of view of not only Soviet Union, but all Europe, all Asia, invasion Cuba, again the Castro, the people who fought for their independence. And you have to remember it was the beginning of this decolonization. In 1960, it was United Nations session on decolonization. So it is one just episode of these things. It was not simply American-Cuban things. It's part of this thing. So Americans show themselves that they are not supporting the liberation movement at the free democratic country, that they are on the side of the colonial powers of the French Empire, British Empire, all other former empires. So through this, he couldn't understand. If they decided to do this for some purpose that he also didn't understand, why he have to remove Castro on this small island, why they didn't finish it. But it did not really bring too much attention of him. He was more focused on the negotiation of the nuclear test ban treaty that he was very much interested from 1958. And he just started this negotiation and discussion about inspection. Eight inspection, four inspection.
Now, so why didn't Kennedy, if you're going to do this stupid thing, why not go whole hog, for heaven's sakes?
It's interesting, but Sergei's Sergei's recounting of how his father's perplexity at this, Kennedy was also perplexed, actually, truly, at his own behavior. He said to many of his aides right after it, how could I have been so blankety-blank stupid? How could I let them do this? I mean, I know these people come to me, they've got vested interest, they want to throw their weight around. What does that have? What does that do? It takes the American image and it just trashes it in exactly this moment when the world is opening up, when decolonization is taking place. And we want to be on the correct side here, but when you invade a small country, you're not on that side. Now, Kennedy made another stupid kind of assumption, which is, if we don't send in U.S. Marines, the world will be able to say, well, he could have done more, but it's just those crazy Cuban exiles operating out of Miami, and well, what do you expect? No, that's not how anybody saw it. They knew the CIA was behind it. I mean, after all, they took CIA planes and they repainted them with Cuban markings, and one of the planes actually landed in Miami, but when it landed, the paint fell off. I mean, that's the degree of thought that went into this operation. And now Kennedy sends Arthur Schlesinger, one of his White House aides, to Europe, just to verify in another way what Sergei was saying about what in the world? I mean, why do it? But if you're gonna do it, do it. Don't like half do it. Well, Schlesinger came, Kennedy, this speaks volumes about how Kennedy operated. He said, Arthur, I want you to go to London, Paris, and Bonn, and I want you to come back, and I want the unadulterated, I want to know everything they said about this. So Schlesinger said, everything? He said, yes, everything. Schlesinger goes, he comes back in about 10 days' time. To sum it up, Schlesinger said in a briefing, they're not concerned that we lost. They're not concerned about that. But the basic view is that the United States president has lost his mind. He's done the single stupidest thing they can ever remember. And here you are. You speak well, you make great speeches, you went to Harvard, you look right, and my God, the first really important set of decisions you faced, you blew it. And now they don't know if they can work with you. They don't know how to respond to any of your initiatives. So this is Kennedy taking the message. Kennedy asks Maxwell Taylor, general recently retired Maxwell Taylor, who's running Lincoln Center, come back in the government, do a no holds barred analysis of the Bay of Pigs. It's done, the CIA gets the hit. Kennedy decides, unprecedentedly, the top two guys in the CIA are gone. They never had any other director than Alan Dulles. And the deputy director responsible for the invasion, Richard Bissell, their careers were over. So under Kennedy's brain is working. He looks good, he speaks well, but somewhere deep inside there is one Machiavellian Irish politician who's learning the ropes the hard way. This, in a way, was the greatest thing that ever happened to Kennedy because he never believed, quote, their bullshit again. He listened to them and he made up his own mind, but he didn't necessarily listen to them because they were experts. It's because it was his responsibility to listen to them. Now, I think Kennedy worried about was 12. That Khrushchev would think that he was weak, that he could be pushed around. I'm not saying Nikita Khrushchev believed this, but Kennedy worried a lot after that about whether he gave all the wrong impressions to the Soviets.
Okay, let me take that and we'll continue this sort of worrying a little bit. And I wanna remind you of something that Sergei said, that there was an interesting parallel with Cuba as sort of a Soviet satellite engulfed by the US, 90 miles away. And the parallel would be, of course, West Berlin. So West Berlin is engulfed by East Berlin, which is under Soviet control.
In East Germany, yeah.
In East Germany.
Berlin is an island, essentially. It's just
right, so land. here's this, and it's a very similar case where the US the allies, Western allies at that point, had minimal troop presence. But the Soviet Union, the GDR, have massive military presence there. So it's a really, Kennedy worries about Berlin all the time. And basically then, Khrushchev, I think, also did some serious worrying about Berlin. 1961 was a, as Jim said, a hard year. And you had a flow of people coming from East Germany, East Berlin, through West Berlin to leave the Soviet bloc. And the numbers were quite regular, increasing. It was a worrisome time. What's going to happen? There was a lot of tension about Berlin. And so what you had as a solution to at least the fleeing of people was the building of the Berlin Wall. Okay, that is in August of 1961. Now, this was a trauma to the West. But before we get sort of to that, I want to ask Sergei to sort of, can you help us understand how your father was thinking about Berlin? He understood, I think, the importance that it had for Kennedy. So how did he sort of balance what might be taken as a provocative action there with the building of the wall, but also wanting to have, in a sense, better relations with the US?
The Berlin and the GDR problem, it was one of the biggest problems of the Cold War. Because after the Second World War, it was only two superpowers on the Earth, United States and Soviet Union, and they tried to deal with each other. How to do it? It's all about all the takes. And Soviet Union want to be recognized as equal. And you understand that United States don't want to recognize anybody as equal. And if you're not recognized as equal, you are challenging opposite side. That was the policy of crisis. And Berlin there was very painful for the Soviet Union because Soviet Union recognized West Germany as the state. And they wanted the West to do the same for the East Germany and the Berlin, recognized as the state. But for different reasons, especially from the Chancellor Adenauer pressure on the West, America told no. No way. It was a very complicated story. So my father tried to push it in this direction, other direction, do it. But secondly, it was another problem because my father thought that that political system would win, that present better life to the people, not that system that will have more weapons and more nuclear weapons. And for him, when he tried to reform the Soviet bloc, make economy more effective, was the idea that East Germany, especially East Berlin, will be showcase of the Soviet success, will attract the Germans to there. And it was negative, it was opposite. And these people just going out, and he tried to find explanation. And it was one thing that initiated many reforms in the Soviet Union, but we will go too far about this. So it was the contradiction inside the thing. The Walter Ulbricht pressed them, we're losing people, we have to stop this movement out. And Khrushchev told, how can do it? It will be embarrassment for us. We are showing that we building the best life for the people and we will build this wall. We will stop them forcefully. And he rejected this many times. And at last in 61, after the meeting with the Kennedy once more time till now, it will be status quo in Berlin. And Ulbricht came and told, we will collapse. If we will not stop them, let's build the wall. And he agreed at that time, it was the meeting of the Warsaw Pact leaders, and he told, we will not build the wall, not Soviets, you will build the wall, you will build, we will stay behind you, the same American Marines in Cuba, but you will build this, do it. And it was one of the very important in this relations, we don't know, because sometime after, the Walter Ulbricht came to Khrushchev and told, we're building the ships for you, the fishing ships, and we ask you to help us because it's, we have no profit from this. And my father told, my friend, what you're doing? We're building these type of ships. We order these ships to Poland, to you, into West Berlin, same price. It's profitable to the West Berlin. It's not profitable for you. So it's fail of the system. You have even not talk about this because then we have to make these changes. By the way, it was pushed Khrushchev to start new idea of the new domestic reformation in all Soviet unions was never completed. So the Berlin Wall was very unpleasant decision for my father at that time. Mm-hmm.
What did he think the U.S. would do? Was he concerned about that?
He was concerned about this, but he was not concerned too much because he didn't think that building wall on the east side of the Soviet-occupied territory can provoke United States to real war. Because what can be there? If you will start demolish this, that means that you're invading Soviet zone. Mm-hmm. So you're starting the war, because if you invade this Soviet zone, it will be not GDR policemen, workers who build the wall, it will be Soviet tanks, it will be American tanks. And then my father told, we have to prevent first shot. After first shot, not we politicians will control, it will be military, it will be very different and very dangerous story. So he thought that it will provoke some political crisis, but he hoped it will not bring us to the real war. But we have to understand, in 1953, John Foster Dulles proclaimed that it will be policy of the brink of the war. And we have to deal on this. We have to balance on this brink, because if you will step back, your opponent will step forward, it will still be on the brink. So it was there what my father told, very important to understand where this bring, to calculate this, not to to start. And he thought that we are very close to the brink with this Berlin Wall, but not too close to make it very dangerous.
So if we take that point that the wall is being built on East German territory, and therefore, if the West, led by the U.S., tears it down, it's technically an invasion of another country. Seems like an interesting, reasonable point. Was this the point that most of Kennedy's advisors made to him?
No, it wasn't.
Darn.
Kennedy made a speech on July 25th, 1961, that is both poignant and really scary.
This is just before the wall goes up.
Right, after the meeting between Khrushchev and Kennedy, first week of June 1961, and August 13th, when the construction on the wall began, right in there. Kennedy makes a speech. It's all about Berlin. It's a radio and television address to the American people, all three of the networks. Gave him an hour, which for Kennedy was forever. His speeches tended to be short. He said the following: we are basically on the brink of war in Berlin, and the slightest misstep could push us over the brink, exactly the point that Sergei is making about his father's point of view. Secondly, and this was the tactical error, but it's so glaring. He urged Americans who already had bomb shelters to please share them with their neighbors in case, in the unlikely event. But of course, I mean, the near panic broke out over this. It was all about what would happen if events in Berlin continued to deteriorate, which it before the wall was built, had everything to do with the massive outpouring and increasing numbers day by day, massive outpouring of Germans and anyone else who could make it to East Berlin to push over to West Berlin and then head into the West for a new life. Hundreds of thousands of people were doing this. So Kennedy is, third point, he concludes by saying, and very personal, unlike Kennedy to be personal and public at the same time, he said, when I took this job, I had no idea of the pressure that would be on my shoulders. It's almost too much to bear, but we have to bear it, and let's just stick with it. Kennedy reacts to the wall. This is very interesting. Kennedy personally was so relieved when that wall went up that I think he really wanted to jump up and shout, because it solved the main problem. In Germany, it solved the main problem. Unfortunately, a lot of the hardliners in the U.S., a lot of them were in his party, because the Congress was under the control of the Southern Democrats. They were chairman of every committee that had anything to do with foreign affairs. Both houses were Democratic, but that didn't really mean what you might think it means now. They were tough, and they wanted him to knock the wall down. As Janet said, this is, I mean, not just technically, but if, I mean, you throw bombs at another person's territory, that's, you know, I mean, that's
it's not nice. It's,
yeah, I mean, that's war. It's war, preemptive war. And after the wall went up, Kennedy kept holding his press conferences, and one after another, these journalists would stand up and they'd say things like, if you had it to do over again, would you accept that wall? I mean, if you knew it was coming, wouldn't you sort of do something about it? And Kennedy says over and over again, well, I don't know what you have in mind, but if what you have in mind is war, I just don't see how that's going to be to anyone's benefit. He's trying to educate as he brings people along, but again, in 1961, excuse me, nuclear weapons are presumed by many people to be like weapons. Kennedy saw them as just pieces of a doomsday machine. First one goes off, the second one goes off, the first 100 goes off, the first 1,000 goes off, and civilization on Earth ceases to exist within about 12 hours. That was his conclusion. Now, how to act on that basis in the world that was given to him was no easy task, any more than it was for Nikita Khrushchev. Kennedy made another mistake. He sent Lucius Clay. Lucius Clay was the hero of the 1948 Berlin airlift when he was a general in the army. Clay was now retired. He was very popular in West Berlin. thank you. Thank you very much. But Clay was a hawk. Some people said he even looked like a hawk. He had this beak that came. I mean, if you look at a profile, Lucius Clay. Clay wanted that wall down, and he wanted to have credit for it. Kennedy, at one point, called Clay and said, back off. There were rumors reaching Washington that Clay was about to up the ante, put some tanks up by Checkpoint Charlie, all where the main crossover between East and West. And Kennedy was frightened that Clay was going to do something dramatic and put him in a box he couldn't get out of.
Thank you. Sergey, I want to follow up on something that you said, that your father was quite aware that, in a sense, once the first bullet was shot, you said, that he would lose some control, that it would not be something that he could manage. Could you tell me, tell all of us, with regard to Berlin, as sort of the wall is going up and he's aware that there would be at least a political crisis, what kinds of things was he doing to make sure that one shot did not go off?
It is like in any of such things, step-by-step problem. You see what's happening and you're making next step. And I cannot say that he can say what he will do. But when the Soviet intelligence figure out that Clay is trying to send the tanks and bulldozer this Checkpoint Charlie, because the Soviets tried just to push Americans to show their papers to the Germans. And they told, we will not show them. We'll not show them. So they told, first they send them back, and next time the same people, and they just went to the theater first time. They came there, and these tanks with bulldozers behind them. If you will not say the Germans have to check your papers, we will just turn it down. It can bring us to the very dangerous situation. But Soviets were lucky, they knew this in advance. Yeah. So the tanks will come. So Khrushchev told, send our tanks there in this side streets. They will stand there silently. And when America's tank to checkpoint Charlie, first of all, Soviets knew, so it was no German there. All these jeeps with the officers, American officers, just go through, and they go to East Berlin without any problems. And then tanks barely standing there, and then Soviet tanks just slowly just go out of these side streets and stand in front of them, barrel to barrel, doing nothing. Doing nothing, day, hour, second hour. Then it was night, it was became cold, it was October, so don't know what to do. And Khrushchev told, you know, Americans will be very difficult to move back. And he called to the Soviet commander in the Berlin, and he was the marshal at that time, Konev, one of the marshals who took Berlin, and he told, move your tanks back. I thought, America's in front of us. He told, move them back, I swear, in 15 minutes they will disappear. And then they moved these tanks back to the side streets, and 15 minutes, American tanks turn around, and it will be no crisis. So I'm answering you, it mm-hmm. is just like in any of such things, you have to control each step and be very careful that you did not step over that line where it will be no possibility to return.
Yeah.
I think this is a recurring thought that both leaders had at that time, which is really, I think, quite extraordinary, because had it been asymmetrical, with only one leader worried about that and the other leader not, it could have been very, very difficult. I want to actually, based on our 37 years of delightful marriage together, I'm going to give you a bonus right now. But you're going to have 2 minutes. 2 minutes. And 2 minutes only, because there's a wonderful similarity thing here about Kennedy and the corridor. 2 minutes.
So there's all of this probing going on. You know, let's test them. So how far, how many kilometers between Berlin and the border? 80, 90 kilometers?
The corridor?
Through from West Berlin, from West Germany to West Berlin.
Yeah, something around this, about like 100. That.
So we have the right, based on the treaty ending World War II, we have the right to send our people down there, and of course they expected some harassment. They maybe expected to be stopped. But it was everybody knew this was going on. This was going to be a show of what's right, what's ours is ours. Kennedy was so worried about this that he had people at 15-minute intervals during the entire slow-moving entourage down the highway. Every 15 minutes, they reported directly to him on a phone in the Oval Office. This was how nervous he was about this, the question, the point that Sergei makes about you cannot allow one shot to be fired at certain times because that shot will be followed by another one, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And literally, literally, the leaders of the two superpowers at this moment, October the 27th, 1961, exactly 1 year before the most dangerous weekend of the missile crisis, were thinking, no, I can't allow anything to happen here because it could lead to total disaster. It is somewhat miraculous, I think, that two men, different generations, different traditions, different experience, different education, different everything, found themselves, not knowing it, really, at this point, in total agreement as to what the problem was. And the problem wasn't for Kennedy Khrushchev or for Khrushchev Kennedy. The problem was it might get out of control and nobody will be in charge.
Done. Part of your applause at the very end can be for him keeping within 2 minutes. Okay, so now here's a conundrum, actually, because I think you're beginning to get to know these people, Nikita Khrushchev and Jack Kennedy. Some of they're very good politicians. They're very cautious with regard to matters of world peace. So how does it happen that people like this bring the world to the brink of nuclear annihilation? I mean, you would think from what we've told you just up to now that with people like this in charge, you'd be breathing a sigh of relief. But a year later, we have the Cuban Missile Crisis. So Sergei, I wonder if you could just give us a little view into your father's mindset about the evolution into and out of the missile crisis. Armageddon, well, as you said.
Yeah, for the Soviet Union, for my father, it was clear. Okay. They thought that Americans will not stop. They will try to overthrow Castro sooner or later. And it was proved because it was beginning of the Operation Mangusta, and it was explosion, it was the sabotage, terrorist acts. So it was clear, and Soviet intelligence thought, I don't know if it's true or not, that invasion will happen sometime in the late autumn. And my father told at that time, he told me personally, we have to defend Cuba, even risking the nuclear war, because we will lose our face if we'll not defend our ally who is now on our side. We cannot do it diplomatically. Americans will not listen to us in the United Nations. We cannot do it using the conventional forces because we have no navy. America control all communication. If it will be 100,000 Soviet troops there, sooner or later, they will be out of the ammunition. We have to send very serious message. Don't invade Cuba. We are serious. And he decided, let's send their nuclear missiles to show that if you will invade them, they can be used. And it was discussion in the Soviet leadership. And for my father's friend, Mikoyan, who was very cautious, he told Nikita, you understand how dangerous this? And he answered him, Anastas, dangerous not that world, it's aventuristic. But what we can do else to protect Cuba? We have to do it. And they decided to send this. Here it was one big misunderstanding and miscalculation, because Soviets, Russian and European and Americans are different civilization. We in Europe lived all our history with the enemies of the gates. So when Germans were replaced by Americans, it was unpleasant, possible invasion, but people, American and large, German people, were not scared more than before. It was just the duty of the government to protect them. Americans, they lived all the time protected by two oceans. And in comparison, Americans, most powerful country in the world, they're like a tiger. But tiger that all their life grew in the zoo. If you put them in the jungle, it's scared of everything. And it was the same what my father never took into account. He thought, yes, Americans will know that we send these 50 missiles there. America has superiority 10 to 1. And on the delivery vehicles, even bigger. So it will be scandal like around Berlin, and then it will go to business as usual. But the Cuban Missile Crisis became American psychological crisis. Why it became so big crisis? Because Now Americans have this feeling that we can be killed the same as Europeans. Different from Berlin crisis, the Americans thought we will watch them on TV. And they were scared. And when the people scared, it's very difficult to explain them what is happening there. The same, you cannot stop the mob with rolling on you saying, you mustn't go, please stop. And it was became very big and very dangerous domestic crisis because it was the election year. And if American president will accept these missiles in Cuba, what will happen? I think Jim knows better what would happen.
That's your cue, and you've got 2 minutes.
This is not fair. I mean, let's just say he knew Nikita Khrushchev marginally better than I knew John Kennedy. credibility-wise, it's all over on his side. Now, in a missile crisis, I mean, I think it didn't take long for Khrushchev and Kennedy to realize that they were in an even deeper mess than they were the previous year. It seems the more you know about it, the more almost miraculous that they came out of this with little or no damage, that they were able to agree under the most excruciating circumstances on some kind of a way out. We won't invade Cuba. You'll take the missiles out, so on and so on, and find a way to verify it, even though Castro entered the picture in a big way and refused to allow UN people to verify anything or even to come to the island. So it got very, very difficult. And this drove the American right-wingers completely up and over the wall. Here you go again. You've got a chance to remove that damn Castro regime. It's given to, I mean, it's an invitation. Look what they've done. You got to go remove the missiles, and while you're there, you move Castro and Guevara and Raul, a whole bunch of them, put somebody in who's more acceptable to us the way it used to be when Cuba was America's playground, and let's get on with it. No. That, I mean, that was the sort of basic hardliner point of view, and Kennedy knew that that was ridiculous. We're in a new situation. These are nuclear weapons. What if we lose Houston, Miami, New Orleans? You lose any of these cities in the southeast U.S. which could be hit by potentially by missiles from Cuba, and you are going to kill more people than died in the American Civil War. Every day of Kennedy's administration was the 100th anniversary of something that happened in the Civil War. He was steeped in it. 600,000 Americans died in that war, and his view was, we said, we aren't even close to recovering from it 100 years later, and you're asking me to do what? But the point was, of course, how can we get out? And Kennedy and Khrushchev found a way. They had been corresponding, they'd been writing back and forth. They kept that up. There were all kinds of back channels and side channels, and I think the way they came out of it was the way soldiers come out of a trench. They didn't think they were going to survive. They survived, and when they came out, they were almost molded into the same basic mentality. Number one, nothing like this is ever going to happen again. Number two, even if it does, we're going to somehow get rid of those weapons so that the worst we can do is bad, but it's not something that's irreversible. And that's where I think they were headed after the missile crisis. And that's how I interpret what you report. Your father said that after they got out of it, we have six more years. Six more years, if he's reelected, and of course he'll be reelected, and I feel good, I think I'll be okay, I feel good. It sounds like James Brown, I'm thinking. But I feel good, I think I can do this. Six more years, we've got what it takes. We're both claiming victory, we're gonna go on, and it's gonna be really, really important and interesting. And now we get sort of...
It was very important, I will add a few things. It was very important, these two leaders was not the leaders that I first shoot, then think. They want to think. And my father was very worried when he first learned that will be American president speak to the nation. And when he found that he announced blockade, and blockade just only for the ship that carry weapons, it was invitation for negotiation, for bargaining. And he openly saw that violation of the freedom of movement of the ocean, and he stopped all his ships with carry weapons. and sent other ships through this. So to save the face, they show, no, we are not carried by this signal to the Americans. We understood what you're doing. Americans did not stop the ships. They then stopped another ship at the flag of Panama or some other place because there can be no weapons. So they show that they can negotiate with each other. It was, let us go every day back and forth. And it was very different from now. You can imagine what we're saying now. We will not negotiate with our enemies. We will negotiate with our friends. We can negotiate with Jim, but we will not negotiate with Spati. We just not just confronting each other. And my father told me, we have negotiate because it gives you understanding of their position, can explain your position, and have some influence of them. That means bargaining. So it was make these people very different, and it was that results inside the Cuban Missile Crisis that found that through this negotiation, they really can reach some agreement if you're even standing very far from each other. And you are very different in most of your thing, but you have one in common, as my father repeatedly told. We are very different with President Kennedy. It was after the crisis. But we have, he defended his national interests, I defend our national interests. We have one in common, we won't prevent the war, and we can work together.
So, on any of these episodes that we've gone into, these guys are unbelievable experts, and we can go into any other more details on them later. But I think now, I hope, that you have begun to get to know Nikita and Jack a little bit. And so now we get to sort of ask the what-if question. So suppose that Kennedy survives Dallas. He gets a little hit in the arm and he's perfectly fine. And suppose that Nikita also is able somehow, and we want to talk a little bit about this, to get beyond the coup and remain in power. What might have happened? Sergei, I want to turn to you first, and I want to get you to talk about two aspects. One is, what were some of your father's aspirations, especially coming out of this crucible of the missile crisis, where they came so close, backed off, and knew they never wanted to get that close again? What were some of your father's aspirations, but not just aspirations, because we all can have aspirations and dreams. Leaders need to also produce. What would have been some of the big obstacles that your father would have faced so that we want to think about these aspirations as plausible?
I will repeat, my father at that time told that that political system will be victorious. I'm not talking about defeat other system, which will present better life to the people, not that system that will make this military build up because it is just, we're wasting our resources. And I was in the meeting of the Defense Council, and Soviet Union was Soviet military council that discussed the basic strategy of the country. And he repeated what he wrote in his memo in 1959 about Soviet military. He told, we now started to deploy intercontinental missiles. When we will have something about 500 warheads that can reach American territory, it will be enough to destroy American and NATO infrastructure. It will assure that America will never attack us. We will be secure. So we will not stop producing more warheads and produce more missiles. And he told to the missile designer who was in the based on the bank of the Dnieper River, maybe you will then start to design the river ships. And this designer was not happy that he will not design missiles but river ships. And he told that we will reduce our armed forces to less than a million and will stop production convention weapons like tanks, artillery, combat planes, not stop to zero, but to some minimum, because he told nobody will attack us. And I'm excluding, he told, local war. It's different from the McNamara doctrine. He told, in case of the local war, we will announce, we will use nuclear weapons on the first day. Because behind these small guys, in each side you have this big superpower with all this nuclear club. And in the end, if you're alive or losing, you will use it. Say it, use it in the beginning. And he told that we will start to do this at the beginning of this transformation of Soviet armed forces. And also he told that we have to also to reform the Soviet society. I will not go too deep in this, but he told the Soviet command economy is not working. We have to eliminate ministries. We have to eliminate command. We have give the permission to make decision what and how produce to directors of enterprise. And they will relate it with the state only sharing part of their profit, the translated paying taxes. We have to eliminate command of the Communist Party. Very important. That time is no constitution such chapter that Communist Party is the leading force. He told we can eliminate it. And he drew his new constitution where it was two terms to being on the high leadership. It was a permanent parliament. And he eliminated the district party committees and put them under supervision of the Economic Council. And he divided in part regional party committees that also now became under the supervision of the regional economical council. They told, and this council, he told, have to work as advisors. So this domestic reform was something that disappeared made 20 years later. Because if you give the permission to make decision to the director, he cannot make this decision risking your money, the state money. That means that inevitably, he never talked about this, but he inevitably have go to the privatization on this or other level. Mm-hmm. And when they told that we have to make the election not from one candidate, they was asking Mr. Khrushchev, not the leadership, it was the ordinary people who discussed this proposed new constitution would discuss widely. They told, but who will be this one candidate approved by the Communist Party? And he told, maybe it will be some public organization. And they told, no. The Communist Party, the leading party, supervise all this public organization like trade unions, youth union. Then my father thought, he told, maybe we'll have then some other parties, not only Communist Party. This candidate, you can understand that all these could change all this environment. And in 6 years, I think that with their ability and their just motivation to preserve the earth and to prevent the war, I hope that the Cold War would finish close to 69. And we will live in the same world of the competition, confrontation, but the economy like now. We're now not confronting with the European Union or China, but we're still competing with them. And by the way, it was possible 69, not Neil Armstrong alone fly to the moon, but together with the Soviet cosmonaut, because Kennedy sent this message to Khrushchev, and my father told me in October 1963 that I think we have to accept this proposal and start to work together.
But Sergei, a question. So all these things that you're saying that your father thinks might be possible,
yeah,
were not these things the ones that led to him being deposed? Because he would have had made many, many enemies by doing all of those things.
Yes, unfortunately he was deposed because through this reformation he fired about 40% of the regional party committee secretaries. And all of them still remain members of the central committee, which really voted and could and elected Khrushchev. He also created the stronger position on the ministerial level, because all these ministers, they were not stupid people, and they think we know better than directors what we have to produce. It is like CEO of the very big company, and now you have disintegrated, as was happened with Theodore Roosevelt when he disintegrated this company that ruled the United States. And there was also furious. Military, they stood neutral, but they didn't like to be reduced from 5 million to less than 1 million without weapons. Mm-hmm. And that means that most of these officers will be fired. And then he also told that the leading structure, the Presidium Central Committee, also have to become younger. And he unfortunately discussed this with his colleagues. That means that maybe you will be fired. So all of them at some time decided, if we'll not fire him, they will fire us. And then they met together, and on the October 14, 1964, he was fired. And when he came for that meeting and awaiting him, and he told me, you see, if I will do only one thing through my life, that in this country it was possible to remove from the highest office the person without blood, without fighting, I would not think that I lived my life for nothing. So he changed the country, but unfortunately his successor just started to return to the old policy in all aspects, military, economy, political.
So Jim, if you imagine, let's say, the period even within the first year in Kennedy, let's say, is elected, what were some of his dreams and what were some of his obstacles?
First of all, there was an obstacle to getting reelected. Kennedy's late but eventually enthusiastic embrace of the civil rights movement, quite visible after March of 1963, caused his political advisors to more or less write off the South, the so-called, that was known in those days as the Solid South or the Solidly Democratic South. The hope was that California, that he'd lost by 35,000 votes to the Californian Richard Nixon, he could put in the Democratic side, and if Lyndon Johnson could once again, one last time, deliver Texas, that he would be reelected. It's not, no guarantee, but that was an issue, as well as all these foreign policy sort of failures from the standpoint of the really hardliners. He had just missed all these opportunities to sort of shock and awe the Soviet Union. But let's say he was reelected. I mean, he had a good shot at it. He was running against Barry Goldwater, who was a political zero, just a guy that had, he was boring, he was threatening, he had no charisma. Well, I don't know what I've left out, but Kennedy had all those things in spades. So just to tick off a few things, Kennedy would have normalized, if Castro had been willing, he would have normalized relations with Cuba. Just before he died, he was sending people to Cuba, not Americans, but journalists from other countries, France especially, sending them to Cuba with two questions for Castro. Do you understand how dangerous that crisis was? First question. Of course, Castro understood it even better than Kennedy in certain ways. The second question, would you like to do something about it? We've actually talked to Castro on several occasions about this, and it's perfectly credible. Secondly, the limited test ban treaty was signed by the U.S. and Soviet Union, others, summer of 1963. Kennedy, I think like Khrushchev, saw this as just the first step toward a comprehensive test ban treaty, which we're still working on. The reduction of these huge numbers of nuclear weapons, stemming and then reversing this nuclear arms race was a huge priority. He'd seen what happens if you don't exert pressure in the other direction. And so he intended to do it, and he would have had, as Janet and I would like to say, he would have had the the great implementer, which was Robert McNamara, over in the Pentagon, locking the door and not letting the chiefs out until they did what they were asked to do. He had the great articulator in Ted Sorensen, probably the greatest presidential speechwriter who's ever served, and who wrote a lot of those wonderful words we remember when we think of Kennedy. He also had the great intimidator, his brother known as Bad Bobby, who was fierce in his loyalty to Kennedy and absolutely unrelenting in his pursuit of what he thought the president's interests were. Kennedy had a good team. So, you know, I'm not saying he could have gotten what he wanted, but as to ending the Cold War, he certainly wanted to, but that's a more complicated thing. I agree with Sergei that by early 1969, the Cold War would have been thought of by more people than you can imagine as being something, let's get beyond it, rather than let's build up. And we still have Ronald Reagan coming long after this in the 1980s, and some very dangerous moments. Now, one thing here that doesn't directly, I think, concern U.S.-Soviet relations, but is certainly something that, as Americans, we think about all the time. What about the Vietnam War? Answer.
And for that, you're actually going to come to a film that we've made, which is called Virtual JFK, Vietnam, If Kennedy Had Lived, where we go into very good detail.
When is this?
This is on November 21st here.
You're saying so I can't give
hold
that answer.
On that. Well, if somebody wants to ask you after, you're going to answer honestly and wonderfully to everybody. But here, I want to do a quick little focus before we get to your questions, and that is the nuclear issue. Basically, again, it's the missile crisis that I think really gives both Khrushchev and Kennedy an impetus to go beyond just the limited test ban treaty. I have a two-part question for you, Sergei, and then one for you, Jim. So,
are the other panelists allowed to break into the moderator?
They are.
Would you speed it up a little
yes.
bit here?
Yes, right here. You can give that to me.
All right.
Equal is equal. So here's the question. Your father, would he have been able, do you think, to have stopped the accelerated nuclear arms race? And two, if he had a partner in Kennedy in making some reciprocal action on that, would that, do you think, have been enough to delay the coup?
I don't think that it was possible to delay the coup because all this was domestic problem.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It was not related with Cuban Missile Crisis. It's not related to the United States. It was some influence of the Soviet-Chinese relations, mm-hmm. but not with all the mm-hmm. things. And if we talk about the nuclear race, we have to remember that in Khrushchev and Kennedy time, our missiles aimed the political and economical structures. It is 300 missiles enough to destroy this, and we don't need more. It was the same assumption that the Soviet military and the American military that I know now. Then it was shift after Khrushchev. It was Americans' brilliant invention. They told, we will not aim people, innocent people. We will destroy the launch sites of the missiles. I work with this. You have 400, we will build 800, with destroy your 400 missiles. I remember how Soviet military complex enjoyed this idea. They told, and we build 800 our missiles to destroy your, no, your 800, so 1600 And you then built 3,200, and it was endless, because now we're not aiming the cities. You cannot build another 1,000 cities, but these sites you can build one after another. Why it was went so far after any limits that you can imagine? Because they push it to the arithmetics. And I think that with the thinking of Khrushchev and Kennedy, when Khrushchev was able to say to his military, no, I will not pay for this. If they come to him with this idea, he'll tell no.
No. Mm-hmm. Okay. Kennedy, can he say no as well to his military in terms of the way?
Yeah, he can say no. But here you get into kind of very, very interesting ground. We don't normally, or in fact, we don't know who killed Kennedy. We don't think anybody does, but we know that there are a lot of people who enjoy the process of trying to figure it out. But a lot of, Kennedy made, like Khrushchev, he made a lot of enemies, in the military, in the CIA, in the Cuban exile community, and in the mafia. The mafia was building what became Las Vegas in Havana at the time that Castro kicked them out and they wanted back. And Kennedy wouldn't do it. So, yes, Kennedy kept saying no, and he said it louder and louder, and he had McNamara amplify it for him. But, I mean, there's a plausible assumption, I think, plausible but not provable, that all of these forces who disliked the idea that a president wanted to collaborate with the primary adversary to get out of this mess, that they couldn't stand it. Now, we know they couldn't stand it. We just don't know how all that stuff came together, if it did, to remove Kennedy, as Khrushchev was removed in a bloodless coup in October of 1964. What we do know is that he would have continued to say no, and he would have said it louder and louder, and he wouldn't have been running again. He'd been a second-term president. And, I think the direction he's going is clear. Now, the moderator here, am I not allowed to say anything about Vietnam? Or?
Right, not unless somebody wants to ask
maybe
the question.
Maybe I will add one more thing. You may say this, what just came to my mind. The months before removal from the power in the September 13, 1964, Khrushchev was near the Moscow when they showed them this new weapons that was designed. Tanks, artillery, helicopters, tactical missiles, all this. By the way, most of them we can see now in the Russian army, all of them grew from there. And that, after that was meeting, and I was present there because I worked in the military industrial complex with missiles. And he started his speech, I remember, he told, thank you very much. You built all these weapons that looks like a miracle. And would we have something close to this at the time of Stalingrad battle? And then he made the pause, but unfortunately, we don't need them now. And he told, it is too many, maybe very few, because we have to reorganize army. And he repeated the same thing that they told. We have to reduce army, reduce the production of all these conventional weapons. So he told this no. And I remember the face of the Minister of Defense, very gloomy after these words.
Yeah. Just
30 seconds.
Yeah. Kennedy received one of his first briefings from the Strategic Air Command hierarchy, DOD, with lots of flip charts and so forth. And the head of the Strategic Air Command at the time, General Thomas Power, trying to move into a sort of humorous vein, asked Kennedy if by chance, he knew he was Irish, but by chance, do you happen to have any relatives in Albania at all? And Kennedy said, No. He said, oh, well, I just thought I'd ask because Albania is going too if we're going to go to war. They're all going, the whole block. And Kennedy left the meeting early. He grabbed Dean Rusk's arm, actually, and on their way out, many people heard him say, "Jesus Christ, Dean, they call us the human race." It's exactly, this is ridiculous. We've gone over the edge and we've got to stop it, and then we've got to reverse it.
All right, our job up here collectively has been to try to give you a sense of who these people were, what their interests were, what they were trying to do, and then up to you to sort of think about what might have been and why it might matter. So we hope that we've generated a bunch of questions that you have. The floor is open for questions. I think we've got microphones on both sides. And so come and give us a question, please. Sir.
As an American who grew up in New York City in the 60s, living with mutually assured destruction, I never for once thought I'd get a chance to ask a question of a Khrushchev. So this is a unique opportunity for me. But as I listened to you talk, and I listened to Professor Blight talk about the pressure that Kennedy felt from his advisors and how he decided that they were full of, as Jim euphemistically said, cow manure, how did your father push back against what must have been incredible pressure to engage the United States in Cuba?
In reality, it was no strong pressure on my father, because the position of the American hawks were, we have the superiority. The CIA estimated was 18 to 1. 18 to 1. In reality, it was 10 to 1. It's enough. So, and when you have American superiority on this side, you will not say, we have to start this war. Really, it was the Minister of Defense who was on one of this meeting, and he briefed leadership, if war will start it, what will be devastation on the Soviet Union? And I think after this briefing, nobody thought that we have to do something to start really fighting against the United States. And it was very different strategy. 1955, it was Marshal Zhukov, the Second World War hero. He was in the meeting of the Central Committee, the ruling body of the Soviet Union, and he told them, if war will start it now, we will lose the war. And my father, who was his friend, he told, you mustn't say them this, because our goal not to win the war, but to prevent the war. Because if we'll start now military build-up, we will lose for sure, because American economy is 3 times bigger than we are, and we will go out of all the resources much sooner than them. So it was no such pressure on him from military special.
Thank you.
Great. Let's go to this side.
Good evening, my name is Rupinder. I'm a PhD student at the Balsillie School. I am very new to the Cuban Missile Crisis, but it's very interesting to study. I'm curious, one of the incidents that happened was a US plane was shot down and a major lost his life. So the first shot was fired, the first blood was drawn. Could you speak a little bit, both on the Soviet side and the US side, what the reaction was to that incident? Thank you.
Sergei, why don't you
But
go
if
first?
You talk about this, you have to understand, it was the no communication, or it was not such communication like now. And during the war, you have to make your decision just on the spot. If what happened just with you two, they just started to make operational anti-aircraft missiles, and they turned on their radar testing, and they saw the signal, Americans flying over. And they called to the command of the Soviet troops, four-star General Pliev, to his command post, and what to do, this colonel who was there. And he was not there. And they asked his deputy. And he told, I cannot find him. And then this colonel called him, you have 2 minutes. In 2 minutes, this plane will be out of limits of missiles. What we have to do? Let him go and we'll push the button. And this deputy closed his eyes and told, push the button. And he pushed the button. So at that time, it was very easy to start war without White House approval, without Kremlin approval. We know all the story about the submarines and their captains can do it. And also it was the same if America stayed the invasion, because the military doing, they destroy communication center. And after this, it will be no communication with Moscow. Khrushchev will not control this. It will be just general plea or somebody else who will say, we'll have to fight.
The moment the word reached the Kennedy group that the U-2 was shot down was the most dangerous moment probably in history, because there was already a plan that was almost, which was to be automatically implemented, which is that immediately, wherever that missile came from that took out the, that was to be hit and taken out. Word reached them in late October. The question was, could you do it before dark? It was a big issue, because word didn't reach till about 4:30 in the afternoon, even though the plane had been shot down about 10:30. But as Sergei said, we didn't have the instant knowledge. When Kennedy said no, we're going to wait until tomorrow. I'm not comfortable with this. We know two things. One is that Kennedy wasn't going to do it. Kennedy already had a plan through Dean Rusk to the UN via a guy at Columbia that rather than go to war, if it looked like it was coming to that, he had already told, indirectly, he had told the UN Secretary General U Thant that you should say that we want out, that we won't invade Cuba, they'll take the missiles out, and you can throw in the Turkish missiles as well, we'll take those out, but he should say that's my idea, not Kennedy's, and the president will agree with the Secretary General on that. But you can read it in the Kennedy tapes. You can listen to these tapes. When that plane goes down, most of those guys in the room say, in fact, Alexis Johnson in the State Department said, the first blood has been drawn. Khrushchev wants a war. That can't be Cubans because they don't control these missiles. That's Russians, and that must mean that Khrushchev wants a war. It doesn't make any sense, but if he wants a war, the guy that goes first usually does best. Well,
the key thing was the U.S. did think that it was a Kremlin order, and we know it wasn't.
Yeah, and Khrushchev sent he told the Minister of Defense, sent the telegram, don't shoot Americans' planes if it will not massive invasion, because we're close to the diplomatic resolution of the crisis. So both of them tried to prevent any of the things, but I will repeat, not everything were under their control with this communication.
Exactly. Sir.
My name is Thomas Pick. I've lived in Kitchener here since 1975. I've always been in the investment business, but I'd like to ask Mr. Khrushchev a question on history, and I apologize, it's a little off topic, but it's something that I'm fascinated with, and you, sir, are one of the few people that might be able to answer it. I've read a lot about Joseph Stalin. I regard him as one of the most compelling people of the 20th century, intelligent, ruthless, all the superlatives. I'm interested, sir, in what your father felt about him. We know after he died what he did, but if your father was here in 1952 and was talking to us about his relationship with Stalin, what are the things he might say?
He wouldn't say you anything what was in reality. But we know now, that will surprise me, even 1939, when he talked with his very close friend, just two of them, but the daughter of this friend was under the table, he told, we will not forgive this, and he used very strong word against Stalin, all this, his crimes and the killing all these people. But If you are there, you have to follow these rules, like just to avoid more crimes, but you cannot just revolt. If you will revolt, you will be shot. And if you want, we can talk more about this. But you have to read my father's memoirs. It is published by Penn State University. First volume just about Stalin.
Thank you. My name is Matt Roth. I'm a PhD student at the University of Waterloo, and I have a question for Mr. Khrushchev. I'm just wondering if you could share your memory of your father's reaction after he learned of President Kennedy's assassination.
First, I will tell you, they have to bring my book, Nikita Khrushchev and Creation of Superpower, and I just wrote all the story, what was happened that time. He was very nervous and upset. Nervous because he couldn't understand who and why did it. And secondly, he was upset because what we talk, he planned that he will work with Kennedy, and now it's somebody new coming, very unknown person, from very uncertain state from the point of view of the Soviet Union, and we don't know what to do, because I will repeat, in 1963, my father met with the Castro visited first time Soviet Union, and he told him, you must be focused on the building your defense. You have to more focus on the building agriculture, economy, fishing industry, until you have this opportunity. Kennedy will be for 6 years in the office, and I trust him that will not invade Cuba. In 6 years, you can make the prosper Cuba, socialist Cuba, that will live and be the showcase to all the Americans, including the United States. You have to use it. Hmm. Castro didn't use it.
Interesting. Yes.
Thank you very much for the wonderful discussion. My name is Shani Hormozi, and I am a PhD student at the Boston School. I would like to ask just one question. What lessons can be learned from Cuban Missile Crisis that have implications for the current standoff between Iran and P5+1? Thank you.
Questions, Cuban Missile Crisis and the nuclear standoff with Iran. Just one thing that comes to mind is that over the period since the Second World War, the United States has had a big problem dealing with small countries that are particular about their own view of themselves, view themselves with some degree of integrity, not banana republics, so to speak. Cuba, problem, Vietnam, a problem, and now Iran, a problem. The big question is to me, is on the American side. The Iranian side is, they seem quite serious right now, but, President Obama has a problem. There's an institutional attention deficit disorder problem in Washington. I mean, he's got a lot of problems, and some seem a lot more immediate than Iran. He's got a lot of, the Congress is a mess. Everybody knows it, but nobody knows what to do about it. So it's vitally important. And this could, a deal on the nuclear program with Iran would be one of the most astonishing things that will have happened yet in this 21st century, should it happen, because it will reverse one of the bitterest relationships of the last 3.5 decades, since the revolution, since the hostage crisis, since the embassies were withdrawn. It could be really amazing and could lead to so many good things, but that's going to require events in Iran and events in the United States to permit the two leaders who seem to want this to actually go through and follow up on it.
I will add on this whole thing. We have negotiated. I don't think that in the eyes of Kennedy and Americans, Khrushchev was better than Iranian president or Iranian Ayatollah. But you have to go and speak, and then you can find out how you can bargain and what will be the resolution. And by the way, I will add one thing. Soviet Union have the same relation with Yugoslavia, small Balkan state that was Stalin just tried to eliminate all their leaders, assassinate them. And then after that, when Stalin died, Khrushchev told, we have to restore their relations. They fought in the war. They won, liberate their country from the fascists. And it was strong opposition, like here, because Stalin showed that he is the bloody dictator, bloody dictator. And then at last, they make some concession and told, yes, we can invite him to Moscow. And my father told, you see, he the leader of the small, proud country, 16 million people that resisted Hitler and won in the result. And it will be humiliation to him to come to Moscow here to ask what from me. I am the leader of the great power. I am not care because I will not lose anything. I will fly to Belgrade. I will speak with them. And I say, let's improve relations. Relations was bumpy for a long time. It was not improved, became very rosy. But it was just changed this overnight. And here what you have to do, you have negotiate this or other way. But I understand these problems of the President Obama now.
Mm-hmm. A student of ours in the spring wrote a really wonderful paper on the Obama mission to Tehran, where he just shows up. She did a lot of research on it, and it got us thinking that a bold move here and there actually can be very effective.
Yeah. Certainly one of the big lessons, I think, from the missile crisis is that both leaders, with just enough time to work with, began to understand each other and understood that they were in the same position and needed to work collaboratively. Now, the question then was sort of really had the impetus because of the nuclear risk that really felt palpable. I think what you need now with Iran is, again, for the leaders to feel, to begin to understand each other, that they both essentially want the same thing. You may not have the same emotional impetus because we're not at nuclear risk right now, although there's certainly the fear of attack and war. And so you hope that's enough to do that.
Sergei makes a good point. It would really help if people would talk. There's a start.
The fact that we now have regular talks, I think, are quite impressive.
So we're at Camp David, and Ali Khamenei, the supreme leader, shows up with his entourage and goes in, and Barack Obama. Can you imagine the right-wing radio stations? Barack Hussein Obama? We knew, we saw this coming. That sucker is from Indonesia. I knew it all along.
I think we'd have to move to Canada.
We're going to have to move to Canada, that's right.
Yes, sir.
My name is Ken Fry, and I was in high school when the Cuban Missile Crisis occurred. And I want to first express my appreciation for the research and the insights that have been brought together here 50 years later. And my question is, I think, of a personal nature, Mr. Khrushchev. You said your father wanted that the transition of power be done in such a way that it would set a precedent for the country and change the country. What is it that he did? What are some of those things that made it possible for it to be a bloodless coup? And what was his life like after he was deposed?
He was not killed. He was alive, and it was big luck in the Russian history, because in Russian history, the same as medieval European history, it was the rule, if you're losing power, you have to lose your life because it's too dangerous to keep you alive. And he changed this too, because when he won his fighting with the Stalinists in 19 he won on them 1957, and they thought now they will be finished. And even one of them, his old friend, called to him. He told, I hope you will not do with us what Stalin did. And he told, no, who care about this? And they were sent to work on different position, directors of different enterprises. The change created precedent. So he was not killed. He lived near Moscow, controlled by the KGB, but not arrested, not house arrested. He could go any place he want to go, except where he know he mustn't go. It is some political rallies. People could visit him, my friends, engineers, other friends, except politicians. Then they show the Russians politicians, you mustn't go, and in foreigners, because when the ambassador of Yugoslavia, he was second time, have his term in Soviet Union. He was good personal friend of my father in his first term, Mr. Michunovich, and he told the foreign ministry, I want to visit privately Khrushchev. They told, we don't recommend you. He told, no, I insist. The second time told, we not recommend you. His third time told, really, I want to go. He told, you may go. But after that, no Soviet officials will meet with you until you will leave this country. And he did not visit. It was another story. It was such a tough politician, Richard Nixon. At that time, he was not the president. He visited Moscow. And he told, I want to see Khrushchev. And they told, yes. And he wrote note, Mr. Khrushchev, can we meet with you? And they told, we will deliver this note to Khrushchev. They delivered this note just day after Nixon left. but my father was very upset with this, what happened with his successors, that he moved back all his reforms, restore all this centralized economy that he understood is not effective, return back to the system where you have no limits to stake in the power, try to just reverse his position over the Stalin. And of course, they tried to stop him over writing his memoirs. So really, he was lucky, but his life was hard.
So we're very close to the end, and I see Fred wanting us to be at the end, but I'm gonna incur his wrath, because what I'm gonna do is, we have two more questions, one here and one very patient that's been on the screen from somebody who's watching the podcast. But I'm going to ask the panelists to be unbelievably brief with your questions, and then we can do follow-ups post so that we don't keep anybody longer than they want to be here. So, yes.
Hello, my name is Devin Hayes. I'm a student of journalism at Conestoga College. And I was obviously not alive during the Cuban Missile Crisis.
Rub it in, go ahead, fine. We're used to it.
My question is very general, and it's for all three of you. Do you think that the Cold War falls under the definition of war?
Mm.
Cold War?
Is a Cold War war? Jimmy, you get 15 seconds.
Millions of people died in violent conflict during the Cold War. They didn't happen usually to be Americans or Russians, but all over the world, the war was fought by proxy states, and there's no reason to be nostalgic about it whatsoever. It was war.
I will answer it a different way. Cold War was a transition period between real war, when two superpowers collide with each other, fighting the First World War, Second World War, domination of the world, and the existing nuclear weapons made it impossible to win. But they still behave the same way like during the real war, but without this war. And so it is a good name, Cold War, war without war. Mm.
So, Janet.
All right, last question here is from Kenneth in Waterloo. The Cuban Missile Crisis is arguably a non-event. That is, nothing really happened in the end, in the avoided nuclear war. Are the cards stacked against history teachers who strive to convey the danger of nuclear war? Do we need another near crisis to convey the stakes to the YouTube generation?
This is a great question. A Pentagon advisor in the 50s and 60s named Herman Kahn once said that the only way to make significant movement toward nuclear abolition would be to, one would have to experience a small but non-trivial nuclear war. 5-10 million people die, maybe. But he said you'd have to do the negotiating before you bury your dead, otherwise the recriminations would take over and an even larger nuclear war would follow. Now, we all hope that's not true, but there's still something like 19,000 nuclear weapons around the Earth. A very small proportion of that is all that's necessary to destroy life as you know it and we know it. So the question is, how to motivate people when they just don't seem to be in touch with the reality of what will happen. Will movies do it? Will videos do it? Will books do it? Will speeches do it? Some combination? I don't know. But some of us are working on it. We'll see.
We have a special place in our heart for history teachers who are really on the front lines. And I think it's really a wonderful question, first of all, Kenneth, that you're asking that. Because I think, especially now, it's 51 years after the missile crisis, virtually all of the main participants are dead. So you don't even have the compelling first person, I was there kind of stories. So we have to figure out ways to vicariously invent this time machine. Because unless you can, right now, when you study the Cuban Missile Crisis or you hear about the Cuban Missile Crisis, it's already 50 years ago. You knew we didn't blow up the world. We have to figure out ways to get people to try to relive it in real time when people didn't know if they were going to live another week or not. So it's a very important question. Sergei,
yes, and I think that it is one thing we have to remember. In 50s, for the military, American military, Soviet military, nuclear weapons were just weapons. In 55, Marshal Zhukov conducted exercise with real nuclear explosion, and division of the Soviet troops just went through this radioactive cloud, because he told we have to train them how to they will deal during the nuclear attack. So it's need to change mentality. First it was politician, maybe to the politician during the Cuban Missile Crisis and close to this, they started to understand that no, nuclear weapons now it's not weapon that can be used. And the weapon that have to just balance different countries and prevent the war. And we see it happening now because Soviets build their nuclear weapons to balance the United States, Chinese balance Soviets and the United States, Indian balance Pakistani. By the way, I will say the scene, but I will say that Iranian tried to balance Israel's. Sure. And we don't know that they really want to launch anything. They want to prevent to be attacked. So in some way, I think that absolute elimination of the nuclear weapons maybe not will make this world safer, but we have to be very cautious understanding that they are not safe. Because you know that all this complicated technology have required to be very cautious and follow all the procedure. Because the Chernobyl nuclear power station blew up not because it was bad design, because that people who made experiment did say it is absolutely safe, they cannot follow what was they read in the manual, they shut down all this wave, just ensure this with the wire, and then they start experiment. It's happened just what has to happen, what was written in the book, nothing else. Would they follow their procedure, nothing would happen. The same with weapons.
Seems to me this is a great argument for nuclear abolition, but we'll have that one at another time. I'm going to end and pass it on to Fred with 30 seconds of an advertisement. Jim and I have a brand new project that we're working on. It's called JFK's Backbone. You can pick up those cards that sort of will give you some information about it. If you want to know more about it, please sign up on it. There's a sign-up sheet outside. You can do that now or you can do it later. But jfksbackbone.com. And that's it for me. I'm going to turn it over to Fred.
Thank you so much. And a few quick comments before we adjourn. I want to thank our guests for the exceptional presentation. You took us on a time machine journey. It was as though you invoked Kennedy and Nikita Khrushchev right into the room. You know, it's interesting to imagine an imaginary past that might have been. But as you approach the end of the discussion, you also emphasize that it's important to imagine the future we want. And so this exercise tonight had important lessons for that exercise. You know, do we listen to hawks or doves? Do we look for military solutions or do we engage in diplomacy and engagement through negotiation? So for stirring those thoughts and for stirring our imagination and for channeling the spirit of Jack and of your father, Sergei Nikita Khrushchev, thank you so much for coming to Waterloo. Thank you for the presentation tonight, Sergei, Jim, and Janet. The edited video of this evening's live webcast will be posted to the CG website, and we'll also post a blog about this event where you can add your own comments. In addition, watch for a segment of CTV's program W5 on Saturday, November 16th, on the 50th anniversary of JFK's assassination, in which certain of tonight's guests may feature. Similarly, look also for CNN's show AC360 featuring starring Anderson Cooper, which will likely air next Tuesday the 12th. With our experts. The next two public events in the CG Auditorium are both a part of our cinema series. As mentioned tonight, on Thursday, November 21st, you're welcome to attend our screening of Jim and Janet's virtual JFK on the very eve of the 50th anniversary of Kennedy's assassination. And on Tuesday, November 26th, we'll be screening the award-winning documentary Flow, in partnership with the museum's Water Tension exhibit and Wilfrid Laurier University. Be sure to register for all of our events, newsletters, for information on other upcoming events. Thank you for coming to CG this evening. We do have a coffee and juice reception in the lobby. I'd ask you, please, sometimes people are so enthused by the presentation, they rush up to the stage and want to talk to our guests right here. Please don't. Exit out to the lobby. We want to get out there immediately with our guests as well and talk to them out there. They'd love to meet you. So thank you again for coming tonight.